Welcome to Money Talks. I'm Nancy Stark, and with me today is Deanna Booker. She's my personal financial guru, and she's also the Communication Outreach Manager for Consumer Credit Counseling Service of Maryland and Delaware. Mm-hmm. Deanna, before we get started, could you tell us a little bit about what CCCS does?
Sure. We are a nonprofit agency serving, we have been serving folks here on the Eastern Shore and all over the state since 1966. We're offering all kinds of financial counseling, so budget counseling, credit counseling, housing counseling, even bankruptcy counseling. Our goal really is, Nancy, to make it so people can become economically self-sufficient. They can move forward, you know, in their financial goals. So we do that. We try to do that through financial literacy education, financial counseling, just offering any kind of help we can.
Oh, that's exciting. And you know what? This is a great month for me to be interviewing you because April has been declared the National Financial Literacy
Month.
It
is, and I'm so excited about it.
Me too. Me too. Every month could be that.
It's a good time. Yeah,
every
month could be that. Really, really.
But with that said, I think the sooner people learn about financial literacy, you know, the younger they are, that they learn about it, the better.
Sure.
With that said, I think it's a really hard topic sometimes for parents to address with their kids. Why is that?
I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that some parents didn't learn it themselves.
Well, that makes
sense. it's hard to talk to somebody about something, impart some wisdom, you know,
right,
if you don't know, you know. So I think that has a lot to do with it. Another thing I think is that just kind of how we are as a society, you know,
right,
money is really tied in with success and self-worth and all this kind of thing.
It's all mixed together. Right.
So I think that sometimes it can just become sort of a loaded kind of topic. You know, that's hard for parents to broach, especially if parents are in some sort of financial distress themselves.
Or they don't get along with each other
about money.
Right.
So if there's something sort of off about the dynamic, I think it can just be hard to broach. Like you said, it's uncomfortable, I think, for parents sometimes.
And kids pick up on those kinds
of
cues.
Sure, absolutely.
What about, you think that there are parents who think maybe that it should be taught in schools?
I think so. I think parents are just assuming sometimes, oh, well, Johnny's going to learn about that in school. I don't have to sit down and teach him about that. He'll learn that in his classroom.
Yeah.
So I do. I think that's part of it. I think parents believe that that's something that's happening as part of their child's just general sort of education, and it's not.
Sadly, it's not a lot of the time. That's true. Well, with that said, it still starts at home, and that makes sense.
Sure.
How early should parents start talking to their kids about money?
I think the earlier the better. You know,
hello.
Right. Obviously, it's got to be age appropriate. You know, the kind of talk that you have or the kind of talks that you have. But in my opinion, as soon as a kid can count, I think that you could start teaching them some basic sort of money lessons and money management lessons, that kind of thing. So I think the earlier the better. I think that you can use sort of everyday activities, you know, to kind of turn them into teachable money moments.
Oh, that's a good point. And we'll come back to that in a few minutes. What I was immediately thinking about as you were talking about as soon as they can count is a topic that's near and dear to most parents' heart, and that is allowances. Now, that's a loaded question. At least it was in my household.
Yes.
I can remember us debating how much is enough, should we be doing it at all of that type of thing.
Yeah.
Is an allowance a good tool for teaching financial literacy?
Well, I'll just say that I think it can be a tool.
Okay.
But I think it has to be done effectively.
Well, that's the key.
Right. I think there has to be some discussion around, like you said, how much is it going to be? When is it going to be given? Is it going to be tied to specific chores that a child has to do? You know, there has to be some discussion. Guidelines, exactly.
Yeah.
Some guidelines around how it's going to be metered out and what it's going to mean. And then I think if you do, or once you do, decide that you're going to give children allowances, you have to review and you have to go back and you have to say, is it really working and what are they getting out of it, that sort of thing.
That makes full sense because obviously what you would be giving to both in the way of how much mm-hmm. and responsibilities for a 3-year-old is not going to be the same as for a 10-year-old or a 14-year-old.
Exactly. So you really have to make those distinctions. And I think as parents, we just have to be mindful of what's going to go on and what's going to be expected and, mm-hmm. and what is going to come of, you know, giving this allowance. So the allowance you give when a child is 6 or 7 or 8 years old, like you said, it's going to be different as they get older. So I think there just have to be some parameters around it. And I think, too, we have to make sure that we're giving kids the opportunity to learn the lessons that come from, you know, or come along with getting an allowance. So are we using it to teach the kid about savings, you know, right. about spending wisely? So there's some things we do around that. Make sure that the child has a place to put their money.
Oh, that's a good point.
Exactly. So when they're younger, maybe it's a piggy bank. Maybe later on is where when we take them to the bank or to the credit union and actually open up an account.
That's a really good idea.
I think those kinds of things make a difference. We make it meaningful. Another thing, and this is something I've said to clients before, if you're giving allowance, give it in a way in denominations that encourage the child to save.
How do you do that?
So the allowance is $5. You give them 5 $1 bills. And encourage them to put 1 or 2 or however many aside for savings. You can spend 3, but why don't you put 2 away? You give the kid a $5 bill and he's off to the store.
It's gone.
And the whole thing's gone. Right. So you have to do those kinds of things to make sure, like I said, that the child is getting the lesson. You know, getting the allowance, but also getting the lesson. The last thing I'll say about allowances, as parents, we've got to learn to kind of back off. We're teaching.
That is the hard part. I failed it.
Right.
Part.
We're teaching. We're getting out the lesson. But when it comes to the child making their spending decisions, we have to let them make them.
Even if good or bad.
Good or bad. Right. Even if they make a poor choice, they're going to learn from it. So we can't be trying to determine, you know, how they're
going to manipulate the situation.
Exactly. Exactly. Right. How they're going to spend their money. We might say, now, okay, if you buy these $50 sneakers, what is that going to mean for, you know, something else? But ultimately, it has to be up to them.
That makes full sense, but harder to implement.
Easy to say, hard to do.
That's exactly right. Now, we've talked about a little bit that money can sometimes be a loaded issue when parents try to talk to kids about mm-hmm. it. What are some sort of guidelines that you could give as far as how to promote a meaningful discussion?
Yeah, I think the key is to talk about it candidly. You know, as much as you can. Again, age appropriate. But talk about it early. Talk about it often. You know, use the times that you have with the children. So you're in the car or you're sitting at the dinner table. It doesn't always have to be sit down, mom needs to talk to you, you know, seriously.
Right. In other words, it's better if it's relaxed and open.
Exactly, exactly. Because I know we can remember if our parents were talking or we felt like they were nagging us, we're just going to tune out, you know, so.
You know how many times I've heard money doesn't grow
on trees. Exactly.
So many times.
And after you hear that for 600
you
times,
forget.
You're not
you
going to listen.
Hear it anymore.
Right? So I think that the conversation has to be relaxed. The parent and the child have to be comfortable. And I think that's going to be the best way that the child gets something. Like I said, gets the lesson that we're trying to give.
It probably makes sense to try and promote questions. Ask if there are questions.
Sure.
You know, one of the things that I noticed with my kids in the beginning is there's a lot of jargon that mm-hmm. that's attached to money. And when you're talking jargon, we automatically know what an ATM is, for
right.
instance.
But a child might not.
Might not.
Exactly.
Right.
So you're exactly right. Don't use that jargon. Don't talk in terms over their heads. But again, make it relaxed. Make it comfortable. Something that the child is going to be sure to be able to take something away from. Just do it in everyday sort of situations, I guess is what I'm saying. Everyday kind of activities.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that. What kinds of everyday activities can you use and how is that effective?
Right. I really think it is more effective because, again, it takes some of the highbrowness off of it, kind mm-hmm. of. So I think you're in the store and you're grocery shopping. That's a great time to teach your child about comparing prices or, you know, coupons and what they mean and how they work. Brand names versus generic, those kinds of discussions you can have. I think it's in a relaxed setting, but it's an everyday kind of experience that the child is really going to be able to relate to, so therefore kind of take away from.
That makes sense. And mm-hmm. it also, I think all of us learn better when we have a practical application.
Absolutely.
For what we're looking at.
Absolutely.
What can parents do themselves so that they're really prepared to give financial lessons?
Yeah, that's the thing. I think that's a point we should make because, like we were saying before, it's hard for you to give a lesson if you don't know about it.
So yeah, if you can't really teach it.
Right, if parents are having trouble, if they don't really know as much as they'd like to, if their finances, you know, aren't where they need to be or where they'd like them to be, it's the time for parents to get help so they can impart some wisdom and some knowledge to the children at a later time. So parents need, if you need that outside help, like we say all the time when I'm here, don't wait, get it, don't hesitate. Call a qualified, reputable credit counselor, get the kind of help that you need. If it's about your budget, how to budget, mm-hmm. you know, how to look at expenses, or if there's debt that needs to be dealt with, all of that kind of thing is going to hold parents back. You know,
that's
from
true.
Being
the
able,
less you know, the less you can really
impart. Exactly, exactly. Yeah. So I think that's a good step for parents to take if they need the help.
Now, I know CCCS offers free, totally free credit counseling and budgeting counseling.
Absolutely.
How do budget and credit counseling work?
A client, a person, a parent would just mm-hmm. call us up, 1-800-642-2227. Call our number. You're going to talk to a counselor. You can schedule an appointment or you can have a session immediately right then, depending. You can go in and see someone face-to-face in an office, whatever time you'd like. During that session, the counselor's really going to go through a complete and thorough financial assessment with that parent, talking about what the budget is, what the expenses are, really where they stand financially, to be able to offer some options. You know, let parents know what might be available, what might be the best things for them to do.
And also teach them about some important concepts that they can take home to their kids.
Absolutely. That's the whole idea.
That's an amazing service.
Right.
It's funny. I mean, going back to that whole thing as far as wanting to have it taught in the schools, I think that's a wonderful idea, mm-hmm. and I really think it's necessary.
It is.
I mean, from the standpoint, when you think about it, you learn how to do math, you learn how to read.
Right.
Learning how to manage money is certainly one of those
exactly.
things you're going to do all the rest
skills.
Of your life.
Life skills, exactly.
And I know I heard that Maryland passed requirements, I think they went into effect back in September of 2011.
That's right.
Where school districts within Maryland are supposed to offer financial literacy lessons to kids that are in grades 3 through 12.
You're exactly right.
What can parents do to help promote that?
Yeah, I think it's really important, and I'm so glad you brought that up. I think it's important because I think children get more of a takeaway, or they take away more mm-hmm. when they're getting some information, the same information, the same good kind of information from different directions.
Right.
So if they're getting it at home, they're getting something at school, they're really able to soak it in. So parents really need to advocate for that. So
right.
they want to check with their school officials, talk to community leaders, find out, you know, if that curriculum, if those lessons are being implemented in the curriculum in your child's school.
That's a really good idea.
Absolutely. And if they're not, you want to work on making so they are. Talk to the PTA. See what's on the agenda. See, again, what community leaders know about it and where it is in the process. It's information that you really, really want your children to get in school, so we really have to advocate for it as parents.
That's excellent advice. Mm-hmm. And on that note, we're going to switch gears. Well, on that note, and that's excellent advice, by the way, Dee, we're going to switch gears.
Okay.
And we're going to talk a little bit. Spring's in the air, of course.
Yes,
this is
weather.
Also, it's an excellent time for adults to make a fresh financial start as well.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the areas I think all of us grapple with throughout our adult lives is credit.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it important to have a good credit history?
Well, because your credit rating, your credit history impacts so many areas of your life.
Mm-hmm.
I think more so than some people imagine. It's not just, you know, when we talk about your credit rating, your credit report, it's not just about credit anymore. Obviously, lenders, anybody you're
they're
looking to
check.
Get credit from, they're going to check it and they're
right.
going to see, and it's going to have an impact. But also employers. Now, not every employer, but employers in select kind of industries, they can
check.
Look at your credit report. Yeah. And they can use what they see in your credit report in any decision, whether to hire, fire, promote, give
wow.
security clearance, that kind of thing. A landlord, say you want to rent an apartment or a property somewhere, landlord's going to check your credit report.
You don't normally think about that, but that's true.
They absolutely are going to. Because it lets them know, it lends some sort of credence to maybe what kind of risk you might pose to them, how you're going to pay your rent. They're going to look at how you pay your credit card bills and
that
everything
makes
else.
Sense.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes full sense.
Here's something that a lot of people don't know. Insurance companies.
Really?
Oh, yes. Are looking at our credit reports when they're determining what kind of premiums we're going to pay for our policies, our car insurance.
So it can affect how much you actually end up paying down the road.
Absolutely. So it really has a wide-ranging effect. It has a lot of impact over a lot of different aspects of our lives.
Boy, I would never guess it has that much impact.
Sure, absolutely.
With that said, who does the actual compiling of the information and what kinds of information is compiled?
Great question. There's a lot of information compiled in your credit report. It's compiled by different sources, or from different sources, I should say. The data is gathered from different sources by the three credit reporting agencies, Equifax, Experian, and TransUnion.
Okay.
So they gather all the information, and it includes all kinds of things, all of what we call your personal identifying information. So your name, your address, your birth date, your social security number.
Who you are.
Who you are, exactly.
Right.
That kind of information is contained in your report. Also, all of your payment history information.
That's important information.
Everything involving how you pay your bills and how you have paid your bills. So there's historical information there about your payment history. There's also information there that is gathered on you, about you, from the public record.
Right.
So any sort of financial liens, say tax liens, judgments, that kind of thing, that it bankruptcy, if you've ever filed bankruptcy.
Oh, that would be a big one.
Yes, any kind of information like that, that's financial information, that's matter of public record from the courts, that kind of information is in your credit report. So it contains a whole lot of things.
And I'm going to bet that it isn't always accurate what it contains.
You're exactly right.
Yeah, given that it comes from a lot of different sources.
You're exactly right.
What can you do to help guarantee that what's there is correct?
Right. The first thing that you've got to do is get your credit reports.
Ah.
You've got to get them and review them regularly. We are all entitled by law to a copy of each of our credit reports from each of the bureaus, all three of them, once a year. So I can't stress enough how important it is to get them, to review them, to make sure, just like you said, that all the information that's there is accurate. If it isn't, if you find some information that shouldn't be there or doesn't belong or is fraudulent or isn't yours, you want to take steps to have it investigated. You have the right to send a complaint, file a written complaint, so to speak, with the bureaus that indicates that there's some information that's fraudulent.
Then what do they have to do?
They have to investigate it. So they're going to look into it. They also have to take the data, any pertinent data that you give them, and send it to the original entity.
The folks that actually compiled the data.
Exactly, that compiled the data. They have to investigate it. At the end of the investigations, the Bureau is going to send you, a copy of your credit report showing that where the information was removed or however the situation was resolved. Now, if it wasn't resolved in your favor, you have the right to put an alert, a written statement on your report.
Giving your point of view on it.
Exactly.
Which makes sense.
Exactly.
And so
it does. It gives you the opportunity to kind of tell your bit of the story.
So that there's a balance there.
That's exactly right.
Well, that's all really interesting information. We've talked a little bit about credit reports. How is a credit score different from a credit report?
Well, the credit score is the number. The credit score is like a numerical snapshot, you know, so to speak. It's a mathematical model. It's the number that's derived from all of the information that's been gathered to make that makes up your credit report. And that number sort of identifies the level of risk that you pose, or the level of risk that somebody might incur should they decide to lend to you or you know, finance a good or a service to you.
Oh, that's interesting. How do you know if you have a good credit score?
Well, credit scores range from about 300 to about 800. A credit score of 700 or higher is good, for lack of a better word.
Right. Meaning that you're more likely to get credit.
Exactly. You're more likely to get things. You're more likely to get favorable rates, that kind of thing. A credit score 600 or below, you're more likely not to. Right, right. And even if you were to be given credit with a credit score like that, the terms are going to be worse. You're going to pay higher interest rates, more fees, that kind of thing.
Well, say you have a good credit score. That's certainly something to work toward.
Sure.
And once you have it, you want to keep it.
Absolutely.
How do you maintain a good credit score?
The most important thing, I can answer this without any hesitation, the most important thing in maintaining your credit score is paying your bills on time.
Oh, that makes sense.
Oh, my goodness.
And in full.
And right, in full if you can, but at least on time. 35%, that's a huge portion, 35% of how your credit score is determined is based on your payment history, how you pay. So paying your bills on time is very, very important. Not letting bills be late, not making partial payments, not letting bills go into collection, avoiding all of that and paying on time is the best way to make sure your score, you know, stays high, that you're able to maintain it. And also checking your credit reports, like we were just saying a moment ago.
Or your credit score.
Right. Reviewing them, finding out what's contained in the report, checking on where the score is falling, you know, every so often. So you can make sure, you know, that everything there should be there, is accurate, and also you're keeping an eye on the information. You're keeping an eye on how the reporting is taking place.
I'm going to throw you a curve here.
Okay.
With a credit score now, you said with a credit report that we're allowed one free, one from each of the reporting agencies each year, of the major credit reporting agencies or credit reporting companies.
Right.
Is that true for the credit score too?
It is not. It is not. When you want your credit score, you will have to pay for it. Depending on which bureau you get it from, you might pay anywhere between $9 and say $14. But I really feel like once a year, It's not a bad investment.
It's certainly worth
doing. Yeah, it's not a bad investment.
Just to
check that number, because that number is sort of the lens that a creditor is going to view you through. So you want to be able to view yourself how they view you. So it's not a bad investment to pay for it and check it out.
And check it out. Mm-hmm. That makes full sense. Well, say I don't have a good credit score. I'm actually a credit risk at this point. How can I work towards improving my score?
Right. The best thing that you can do is work out a plan to pay down the things that are already there. So if you've had some, maybe collections, maybe things went a little bad, you want to get on a plan to get those things addressed and have them paid down. Even though the history is there, even though they will remain on your credit report for a period of time, you want to make sure that you get them paid, that you get them handled so you can move forward, so you can start to build up positive history, in the time frame. So if you need, again, outside help with doing that, don't hesitate. And then you just want to continue that positive path. You want to pay your bills on time. You want to make sure that you stay on your budget. You want to make sure that, you know, you have things on track so you can keep that positiveness going.
If you need that outside help, where would you go?
You'd go to Consumer Credit Counseling Service of Maryland and Delaware.
Why am I not surprised?
But you can. You can call us at 1-800-642-2227. Talk with our counselors. We're offering free budget credit counseling. We're able to do that assessment that so many folks need, offering up the options, maybe a debt management program, which is something that we offer. Maybe that's going to be beneficial for you. Maybe there's some other options that our counselors can help you work through. So if you need the outside help, definitely get it.
That's a good place for us to stop. I have a little surprise for you.
Okay.
We actually have a letter from one of the folks that use CCCS.
Oh, yeah.
And they got counseled here locally. So I thought you might be interested in hearing what they had to say about you.
I would love to. That's excellent.
This is what they say. Dear PAC14, I am writing because I recently completed a debt repayment program with Consumer Credit Counseling Service of Maryland and Delaware.
Hey.
For years before, I'd done what most people, or many people, I'm reading this wrong, I've done what many people do. Mm-hmm. I bought things on credit without considering if I really needed them. Mm-hmm. This landed me in thousands of dollars of debt with 4 credit cards charged to the max. And to deal with this, I initially signed up for a debt settlement company, but after 10 months of paying them, I had little to show. They simply took my money to cover their fees without resolving my debt.
I can tell you, Nancy, and I hate to interrupt you, but that's not unusual. We have so many clients who come to us and say, I wish I had known. I went to this debt settlement place. I went to this debt repair place, and they promised me the world and didn't do anything.
That's so sad.
It's awful. It's awful. What I hope she writes about what happened to her.
Well, what she says is, luckily my mother heard about CCCS from a local attorney. She encouraged me to call for a credit counseling appointment at the Salisbury office.
Good.
When I went in for the appointment, my counselor, Victoria, was great.
Ah,
isn't
great.
That cool?
Yes.
She helped me understand my financial situation, set up a personal budget, and explore ways to cut my expenses. She also offered me the opportunity to enroll in CCCS's voluntary debt management program. Now, that's exactly what you were talking
about.
Exactly.
I can't wait to hear more.
She says, for the 2.5 years that I was in the program, I made a single payment to CCCS each month, and they distributed it to most of my creditors. Is that how it always
works? That's exactly how it works. Exactly.
Good. It wasn't always easy because I had to learn to live without credit cards. But along the way, I learned valuable financial skills.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Wonderful.
I'm sure that makes you feel good.
It does, Nancy, because that's what we're after. Yeah. It's one thing, and it's a great thing when someone pays their debt off. But what we're after is for them to leave our program not only debt-free, but also with some skills and with something that they can, you know, take along and teach to the kids.
That's a good
that's
point.
That's wonderful.
What she says is, for the first time, I really had to think about things before I bought them so I'd have enough money to get from month to month. I learned how to economize on things like buying produce at the farmer's market to save on groceries. I also learned how important it is to build up savings for emergencies.
That's wonderful.
And guess what? She graduated.
Yay.
She completed her program, she
Very
says. I'm
good.
Happy to say I paid off my last creditor in October of 2011.
Good for you.
Yeah, I was great. Not an easy
That's
thing to
excellent.
Do.
Excellent.
For the first time in a long time, I am truly debt-free. Since then, I've continued to practice the habits I learned in the program.
Wonderful.
I still live on a budget, and I have a savings plan. Before I buy something, I always ask myself, do I really need this? How will it benefit me?
Right.
Those two small questions help me avoid making impulse purchases.
That's excellent. Yeah, that's excellent.
Isn't this wonderful? I bet this is music. This would be music to my ears.
It is.
She closes with, we all run into problems in life where we need extra help and someone to talk to. In this way, CCCS helped me.
That is wonderful.
They gave me the tools I needed to repay my debts. The financial skills I gained in the program will help me long into the future. They help keep me financially secure.
Well, that is wonderful.
Isn't that I thought you'd enjoy hearing that.
There's nothing better than that for me. I tell you the truth. There's nothing better than that for me. And I've been doing this a long time. And one of those letters or, you know, a person calling up and saying that kind of thing, that we help them and they have some skills and they're better off. And it's the greatest.
It's wonderful.
It gives me goosebumps
to know you have that kind of an
yes,
impact on people's
it's
lives.
It's wonderful.
There's
I'm
no
very,
doubt about it.
I don't know who that person is, but I'm very proud of you, whoever
yes.
you are.
And we actually are keeping her name anonymous because confidentiality
Absolutely.
Is an important part
sure.
of what you do.
It certainly
on
is. It certainly is. That's great.
With that said, I think we're going to end on an
okay,
up note
well,
today,
wonderful.
Deanna. Do you have any last minute advice for us?
Well, my same advice. If you need help, don't wait to get it. Call us. Call. Call us at 1-800-642-2227. Talk to one of our counselors or call our housing line, 866-731-8486 if you need that kind of help.
Oh, that's wonderful. Do you have any special tools for learning about credit on your website?
Absolutely. Go to our website, www.cccs-inc.org. Go in our resources tab, all kinds of great tools. Podcasts, interactive things, e-learning modules, great stuff on the website. New stuff, too, so check it out.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yep.
Well, on that note, I'm going to say a big, big thank you to you.
It's my pleasure. Thank
it's
you
wonderful
for
having
that letter.
You here always, Deanna. And a very big thank you to Pac-14.
Yes,
we couldn't get along
you,
without
Pac-14.
You. And on that note, happy Financial Literacy Month, everybody. Go out and learn some more.
Would you like to see your community organization or nonprofit group featured on Pac-14? To get started, contact us at 410-677-5014 or visit our website at www.pac14.org. Pac-14 is a great way to connect with your community.